A very good evening to you. Welcome to another News Make Alive program right here on DBS Television with me, Timothy Polio. We go up until 10 o'clock this evening, which time we'll be concluding with the clip that peaked. Well, today is a special day in the history of the island, March the 1st, Flag Day 2017, and that is the Golden Jubilee of the St. Lucia flag, celebrating 50 years since the island's flag was designed by Honorable Sir Dunstan St. Omer and first used when the island attained associated statehood on March the 1st of 1967. And unfortunately, Sir Dunstan passed away on the 5th of May 2015. One of his sons is on the broadcast this evening. We'll be focusing on his achievement and his contribution to the development of St. Lucia, in particular, the fact that he designed our national flag. We will also be taking your calls later, and we hope that we'll be hearing from you when we give you that opportunity to have your say on the observance of National Flag Day. There's a special ceremony which took place at the National Archives this morning at VG. Homage was paid to Sir Dunstan St. Omer, as well as to Sir Lytton Thomas, who is the individual who composed the music for St. Lucia's national anthem. We have a report from DBS's Alex Bosque.
On Wednesday, dignitaries, invited guests, and students, among others, absorbed the history of the national symbol through various presentations. At the ceremony was Sir Lytton Thomas, a living legend who set the words of the national anthem to music.
We celebrate Sir Lytton Thomas, and we're so happy he's here with us today. The quiet dignity of this hero is immortalized by the enchanting melody of the national anthem. The tune does not invite the blaring of horns and the clanging of cymbals, but the reflective introspection of strings. Your genius, Sir Lytton, is forever inscribed on our vocal cords and in our hearts.
Stepping back a moment in history, director of the Folk Research Center, Mr. Hilary LaForce, spoke of St. Lucia's freedom from the British Empire.
In August 1965, Chief Minister John Compton, whose new United Workers' Party had won the general elections in 1964, moved a motion in the Legislative Council, as it was then known, that the government of St. Lucia seek from Her Majesty's government in the UK full internal self-government by January 1st, 1966. After a three-hour debate, the Legislative Council, the motion was passed by a 9-2. The two opposition members, Mr. George Charles, former chief minister and leader of the opposition then, and Mr. Martin Olio-Jabatis of the St. Lucia Labour Party, voted against the resolution.
Senator Fortuna Bellrose praised the man who designed the national flag, Sir Dunstan St. Omer.
He was very competitive, and to succeed in today's world, you must be composed and you must be competitive. You must be focused. And that was what this man symbolized to all of us. This is what he demonstrated by his behavior across the court. And this is the man who developed our flag. So for me, he was a genius. And to have designed a flag in 1967, which today remains the most relevant, interesting, an attractive flag across the globe. You can tell me what you want. When we put these flags up across the world, ours is the best.
The wife of Sir Dunstan was presented with a token of appreciation in honor of her deceased husband. Governor General Dame Pearlett Luisi also paid tribute to Sir Lytton Thomas.
He began his career as an educator, and we heard that at the age of 16 when he joined the staff of the Viewfort RC Boys School. For the next 30 years, he would rise like a meteor, through the system. As a supervising teacher, an inspector of schools, chief education officer, permanent secretary in the Ministry of Education and Culture, and then principal of the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College. His involvement in education at a regional level has been no less impressive. He served on projects and committees with the United States Peace Corps in the Eastern Caribbean, the Caribbean Examinations Council, CXC, CARICOM, UNESCO, CARNED, which stands for the Caribbean Network for Educational Innovation for Development, the Association of Caribbean Tertiary Institutions, and that is just to name a few.
The Flag Day ceremony concluded with the hoisting of the St. Lucia flag and a minute of silence in memory of Sir Dunstan St. Omer. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Thank you very much, Alex, for this report. It was filed this evening during the DBS News World. Joining the broadcast is Alwyn St. Omer, one of Sir Dunstan St. Omer's 9 children. Welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you, Tim.
How do you feel today on the occasion of National Flag Day? And well, knowing that your father designed the national flag.
Well, I feel very proud and elated. I mean, this is a huge achievement for the whole island, the whole country, you understand? And we hope it's something that's going to be continued to be celebrated in the coming years.
What did it take for the observance to be put into effect in the first place?
Well, Margot of the National Archives, Margot Thomas, she's indomitable. She's a ball of energy. Last year, she invited me to pledge to support this move, Nobel laureate last year. And she's been behind the scenes driving this movement ever since. She got the support of the Governor General and the Folk Research Center, Mr. LaForce, and she invited me as well. So we behind the scenes have been working to make sure this happened and that St. Lucia recognizes this movement in our history. This is a huge moment in our history, and it would be a shame if it not recognized, not just for my dad's national flag, but it's a historic moment in recognition of the people who brought us from where we came from to where we are now. You're talking about George Charles, John Compton, these people who, you know, these people came out of colonialism. You understand, and brought us to where we are now, and including my dad. And it was a time of giants, because all these men were giants that you read about and stuff like that. And I think it's Flag Day is a celebration. And I think right now, St. Lucians should stay away from the politics and look to celebrate our achievements.
But do you think that enough is being made of our achievements? Because so many of our young people right now, they're so disgruntled about their own life. They are despairing and all that. Do you think that there's so much to celebrate from their perspective that they will take a moment to reflect on the fact that we have our national flag and today is National Flag Day?
Tim, this is a curveball, because what it is, the one thing, if to answer this, I have to go back to what my dad taught us. It was all about love, love of country, before the politics, faith in God, and respect for, you know, our friends and our neighbors and stuff like that. And I think, for some reason, we've moved away from that. We seem to be following the politicians and forgetting we have a beautiful country. We have the pitons. We have a beautiful civilian sky and sea, like Daddy says in the flag, you know? We have so much beauty. We have so much achievement, but we cannot see it because we're always fighting. We have to find a way to go back to rediscovering ourselves and rediscovering the beauty we have and finding a way back to our national pride. And we have to guide the children, because otherwise we are lost as a nation.
You made reference to national pride. And very often people say, without any evidence, at least from my perspective, without any evidence, without a research being conducted, that Saint Lucians do not have national pride. And we are compared to countries like Dominica, Grenada, St. Vincent, Barbados, where it is being suggested that the people there really believe in the country, really believe in the national symbols, and celebrate the achievements of their respective territories. Do we, are we lacking in national pride, the way people are saying it? Do you think it's an exaggeration?
I've heard it often. I've often heard it, that we lack national pride. I think Saint Lucians have to rediscover themselves. Like I said earlier, we have to discover, take a drive in the country and see the beauty that we have. We have to teach the children what we have, the achievements of Sir Arthur, Derek, and all these things. And I think we are too consumed by politics. That's why we moving away from our national pride. We have to, Saint Lucians have to, we have to learn to achieve despite the politicians. We have to do whatever we have to do in whatever skill set we have. We are hugely talented people. We are beautiful people. We gifted for a beautiful country. We have to do the best we can to move our country forward and stop looking to the politicians.
You give the impression that the politicians are dividing us. Do you think that they're a dominant force, primarily because we seem to put so much confidence in them, or will we allow them to serve as some kind of influence over us, compared to, for example, if we immerse ourselves in the achievement of Sir Derek Walcott, or Sir Harold Simmons, Sir George Charles, or your dad, Sir Johnson Sentoma? Why do you think we gravitate so much to the politics and politicians compared to those individuals who have excelled in various areas, particularly the arts?
I think it's an economic thing. You know, unemployment and struggle and suffering. Like Bob Marley said, a hungry man is an angry man. When you have 4,000 children leaving school, 4,000 left last year, 4,000 leaving this year, 4,000 going to leave next year, and you go to school, you learn, you study hard, and then you can find a job. Maybe 5% of the kids leaving school this year will go to university. Another 5% have godfathers who could pay for them to go to university. And another 5% may find a job. But we know the economic situation right now. There are no jobs. So what are we going to do with these 4,000 kids leaving this year? And I think that our politicians are so busy fighting each other and trying to stay in power, they've forgotten the people. They've forgotten the skill. We are very talented people. St. Lucia, per capita, maybe more talented artistically than the, what they call, considered artistic motherland, France. But we have to, the word I used earlier on, the term rediscover ourselves, we have to learn to rediscover ourselves. You know, we have to find ways to modify our education system so that our kids leave school with skills, so that we don't depend on a job at J.K. or Valmore in the bank, or at Kibler & Wallace or Lime, or, you know, Kibler & Wallace Digicel. You know, we have to find a way to teach the children confidence so that they could learn to survive. You know, it's a matter of survival, and I don't know who's going to drive, who's going to be the force leading this charge, but we have to lead the charge, whether it's the religious sector, the educators, but the politicians are not going to do it. The politicians are only concerned with staying in power. And, you know, that's our situation.
With the dominant issue being survival, as you just said, do you believe that that is robbing particularly our young people and the adult population by extension of the desire to appreciate things of St. Lucia, in particular, to have a deep appreciation for our national symbols, including the flag, on this National Flag Day?
Tim, I'm Sir Dunson's son. If I'm hungry and my children can eat, I can think. You know, and that's what we created. We created a society of beggars. So that may be the root cause of the problem. We have to find a way around that. And maybe our education, remodeling our education system to fit the new generation coming up. You know, maybe the answer, we can't keep blaming them or jailing them when there's a problem, we just call the police. You know, I mean, that we're going wrong somewhere. We have to remodel our education system, and we have to, this generation now, the older generation now, have to set the standard. We have to do what we have to do, because we cannot keep saying that we have no national pride. We have to start somewhere. We have to. Growing up in the house of St. Thomas, that, I mean, he taught us love. Love of country. He used to take us in the country in his old car. Go all over the place, jet twin, just name it. Taught us how to love our music, our people, what we have. We have to rediscover ourselves. We have a lot of beauty. We have a lot to offer, but we're not seeing it because we're too angry.
What part of St. Lucia is your father from?
My father is from Castries.
Okay.
But you know, everybody who lives in Castries is from somewhere in the south. You know, where they talk of him, of cousins in La Brichoselle, you know, that sort of thing. You know, a lot of people from Castries are from La Brichoselle. You know, so we don't know. My mom is from Anceli Canneries, but she understands she has proper cousins in La Brichoselle. You know, so, you know, my dad is from Castries. And we grew up in Castries when there's a time of a lot of theater and there are a lot of the giants still walking the land. Derek Roderick and all these people. So we grew up in a very exciting time.
Do you remember when your father was, were you old enough to remember when your father was designing the flag? No?
I must have been a little rat, but I can vaguely remember it. I must have been about 7 or 8 or something. I vaguely remember him doing his work, because as a child, we would get up in the night and see daddy working and painting and stuff like that. So he was always working at night. Mm-hmm. I think at the time he was editor of The Voice or something like that. So
well, I think I read it was, he would have, okay. Yeah. He started off as sub-editor. And then subsequently became editor.
After
I think
from Harry Simmons.
1959 to 1962.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, so maybe he may have moved on to the Chamber of Commerce. He was the first secretary of the Chamber of Commerce.
Okay.
Maybe at the time. Something like that.
But as far as your recollection goes, was this the arduous task for him? Was it difficult designing the flag?
Daddy, designing the flag would have been a beautiful thing for him, because Daddy was always fighting to empower the people, empower his people, the St. Lucian people. And as you see this reflected in the churches, with the flag, what he did, he had developed a style which Derek Walcott called prismism. And I think the flag is based on that prismatic style. It's one of the earlier examples of that prismatic style. And you can see his love in the description of the flag. You understand his love for the people in the flag. The flag was also meant to be apolitical. You know? So his flag was a labor of love. And to hear him speak about it, he would say that his flag, when the proper colors are used, is the most beautiful flag in the world.
Because it's being suggested that, for example, the yellow in the flag, which the flag, the color is supposed to be gold, right?
It's gold, yeah.
Right. But looking at it, I see yellow. Is that where the politicization comes in of the flag?
Well,
with the yellow?
When Daddy designed the flag, the Labour Party's colors was blue. The star, the blue star, mm-hmm. and the banner was blue. And the UWP's color was green. So you can imagine the flag has the cerulean blue representing the sky, and beautiful translucent seas, and the black and white representing the people, the black being the dominant race, you know, and then the gold was meant to show our sunshine and prosperity. You understand? The triangles, incidentally, because of the shape, is meant to show our hope and aspirations of a people. Mm-hmm. You know, because the pitons have that triangular shape, and that's what. So it's a beautiful flag.
Continue to be so much confusion over the blue. Is that the right blue? It's supposed to be cerulean blue.
When I designed the flag was an aquamarine blue. It was an aquamarine blue. I am too young to quite remember, and I know there's a very vague history of it. I'm not going to, but I from discussing this with Margot, who is a historian, and she has all the information at the archives. She says that Daddy modified the flag, and I vaguely remember this as well. Daddy modified the flag for independence. He modified the blue in the flag to cerulean blue for independence. So he used it to show the movement from statehood to independence, a new beginning. You know, so he used this more beautiful blue, more reflective of our ocean and our skies to show this new beginning. In fact, when we became independent, that is an eternal dreamer. He thought that his dream was for St. Lucia to become the new Hong Kong, you know? But again, the politicians wanted to take it somewhere else.
Why the new Hong Kong?
He thought that St. Lucia was going to be a driving force in the Caribbean. He thought if these young brains, Compton had taken the country to one, you know, and he thought it was going to be a new beginning and we are independent and stuff like that, you know. Because remember, it was a whole generation, it was a process, a journey from colonialism to now. So these guys were coming out of colonialism. And my father in particular was always interested in empowering his people, and he did it through the major religion at the time. Remember, as a young boy, at 24, he painted the Grozile Church. And in those days, black people of our thing was not, you wouldn't dare paint them in the church, you understand? So Daddy had a challenge of, as a young man, at 24, he was trying to put black people in the church. And he cleverly, there's a part on the right side of the Grozile Church in the mural where there's the Virgin Mary looking down on the people on earth. There's a cloud cover. And then as in the shadows of the cloud, he had brown, black, yellow, and that's how he got black people, he got our people in the church. The Rosa Church is another development that came out of Vatican II when, you know, the church realized that the church has to be part of the people and part of the community for it to grow, you know? And what he did was he used the people of the Rosa community as the saints and as the angels in the church, and he was able to do his black Christ.
So and it was a next quite step. Controversial.
Yes, it was quite controversial, but it was his daddy always was concerned about what we call the ghost of slavery. We're still haunted by the ghost of slavery, and he was always concerned with empowering his people, finding ways to empower his people.
What do you think we are preoccupied with? Do you have people of this generation who are of this kind of mindset?
I think it's a whole new generation. When we were at school, we had these books we had to study, but this children have iPad and all kind of thing now, and you know, and phones. You jump in Carnival and people have you live satellite on the phone, you can see, anybody can see. It's a whole new world now. And what happened if, is what happened in the connecting generation after the generation of the Arts Guild. You know, the Harry Seymans, Johnson & Toma, Derek Walker, that set, George, you know, that set. There's a connecting generation, and then there's a generation now. I don't know, rebellion. I don't know, but we still are very beautiful people. The young people are very talented. I mean, when you look around, I mean, when you see the quality of things the children are doing now, the writing, the music, the painting. There was a young girl working with me at the when I was painting the Huasho mural, Sabrina Romulus, an incredible child, talented. You see, we are very gifted people. And what are we going to do with all this human resource? How do we harness it for the good of the country? You asked me what the continuum from the post-colonial generation, but maybe they were fighting for something. What we have to ask ourselves is, what are we fighting for now?
Do we know? Do we have an idea? Do we have a project?
Our project is,
because I remember once
our project is red and yellow.
So Hilary Beckles delivering a lecture, I think it was at the conference room of the Cultural Development Foundation, is saying that there was an era where you had the Black Power movement, Rastafarians had a project and so on, but now it appears that we do not have a project. We're not preoccupied doing anything meaningful to get a positive kind of outcome out of that particular project.
I don't know. I don't know. We just, each of us have to, in our own small way, do something. Help a child, help somebody, because we can't depend on the status quo. You understand? You know, each of us have to, in our own way, have a little project to do something to help the youth, to help a community, to help self-help. Maybe we should go back to self-help and then see how far we can go. You know, we have, like I said, it hurts me to see the talent that is being wasted. Talented youth become frustrated and they end up doing all sorts of things. So we have to find a way. You know what is an irony to me? When I see the five cruise ships come in the harbor, nothing to buy in Central Castries. There's no local craft. Most of the craft in the vendors market and vendors arcade is from Taiwan or I'm not knocking anybody, from Haiti or, you know, it's not made in St. Lucia. Our tourist industry sometimes is like rainfall on a hot sidewalk. It has taken government so long to understand that maybe if all that talented youth probably should have a craft center in Anseré, in Soufré, develop the one, redevelop the one in Choiseul, and get the kids active, producing stuff, producing indigenous St. Lucian stuff, you know, where the tourists would be happy to walk into these centers and buy and see people doing, making genuine local stuff.
What is preventing the private sector from leading the charge on this particular issue, as opposed to just looking to the government? If there is an avenue, if there is a void to be filled, don't you think that the private sector should realize that and take advantage of it?
The private sector in St. Lucia traditionally is a merchant sector, you know, and the St. Lucians who have been successful haven't found a way to give back. I've always found that, you're right in that we always depend on government, you know, and government can possibly do everything because we're not a wealthy country. But you're right.
Don't we have our own craftspeople who can coalesce around that particular issue, can come together through a cooperative and establish a market, an industry that is worth investing in?
But it needs finance. Everything needs finance. Everything needs... you need that jump start to get the materials, you know. For example, if for some, by some instance, we get grant funding to open these centers, even when the grant funding, the money is completed, but it's finished, the funding for the project is finished, the kids could continue to produce stuff because now you have, they have a skill, and then they can go and get their own materials because they're earning money from the tourist industry, because the tourists are coming to buy genuine local stuff. And now we're really making a turnover. We have been able to, I started in Jamaica for 3 years, and the Jamaicans have what you call tourist traps. You must buy when you come there. In Montego Bay and stuff, they have these huge craft villages and stuff like that. People come in and buy, and people are happy to get to walk around and be involved and see people doing these local things. There's no art in local in open spaces in St. Lucia. In a country of Derek Walker and Dunson Santoma and Harry Simmons, there's no art in public spaces, except for the couple of murals I have at Fuasho, and the statue outside the bank, Bank of St. Lucia. There's no art in public spaces. There's no way a tourist will know these people have any culture at all. And on top of that, the city needs revamping. The city needs cleaning. The city needs a redevelopment. You're not going to invite people to your home and you're not ready.
Mm-hmm. You're watching Newsmaker Live on this National Flag Day. Once again, my guest this evening is Mr. Alwyn St. Omer. He is the son of Sir Dunson St. Omer, who designed the flag. When we come back, should the flag be redesigned? We'll be discussing that issue in just a moment. Welcome back to the broadcast. Once again, you're watching Newsmaker Live on DBS Television as we continue to observe National Flag Day. And who better to speak on this issue but the son of Sir Dunstan St. Omer, who designed the flag. And my guest is Mr. Alwyn St. Omer. A little later, I'll be taking a call, so please stand by for that. It was on February 21st, during the RCI Newspin program, I interviewed Mr. Peter Josie, one of the individuals who participated in the discussions, pre-independence discussions over in the UK, representing at the time the opposition St. Lucia Labour Party. And he suggested that, for example, in the event that St. Lucia were to become a republic, he's saying that he wants to see some changes. And two of them would be, for example, to look at the national anthem, and also to modify, redesign the St. Lucia national flag, and to include red in it. So let's listen to Mr. Peter Josie.
Everybody to get some colors that represent the people, maybe even more than they do. Because we have shed a lot of blood in our struggles from slavery to now. I'm not talking about the kind of blood that has been shed in one-on-one violence. I'm not talking about that. But red is not a color we should, you know, just neglect and poo-poo. It's a real color in life. It's the color of blood. You understand? And each and every one of us has blood flowing through our veins, and all of that blood is red. Okay? We can say blue for the Caribbean Sea. We can say yellow for the sunshine that's forever on us. Or whatever mixture you want. But that is my personal opinion, okay? So I don't make excuses for rendering my personal opinion. And for the sake of everybody.
Okay, so you heard that comment, that suggestion being made by Mr. Peter Josie.
Yeah.
Mr. Sentoma, what say you, sir, to this?
Well, with respect to Mr. Josie, you know, I mean, my father was a master colorist. That flag is a masterpiece. The flag is a masterpiece of incredible, it's his work of art. It's his work of art and tribute to his people. Remember I told you he was interested in empowering his people and removing the ghost of slavery and all this sort of thing like that. So this flag is based on, he used the pitos in the flag to show the hope and aspirations of the people. He used the cerulean blue to show the our beautiful seas, the multiculturalism with the black and whites and stuff like that. The flag is the embodiment of everything St. Lucian, you know?
So do anything to be desecrating it?
We'd be desecrating the flag. We'd be desecrating the flag. I mean, I wouldn't dare touch Daddy's flag. I mean, it's a beautiful flag. If it's not broken, why fix it? It's an absolutely beautiful flag.
What if it happened? I know there'll be some upheaval by the led by the Sentoma family.
Not by the Sentoma family, by probably 75% of St. Lucia.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think people are proud of the flag. You know, you see the Americans changing the flag, you see the British changing the flag because of this. You think the British are going to change the flag because of Brexit? You know, it's not going to happen. Your flag is the flag is St. Lucia's most recognizable symbol. And you're not going to change your signature. You know, you're going to change your face. Why change your flag?
How was St. Omer, selected to design the flag? Was there a contest? Was he commissioned particularly?
There was a contest, and he won the contest with two designs. Mm. You know, the first one was a more radical thing, more like what Peter Josie was talking about. But the other one...
But the other copy, would you have it? Would you have
that copy is lost.
Oh, okay.
But earlier today, MacDonald Dixon, who had seen it, it was really a radical, it was because Daddy came out of this, like I said, this colonialism where we're fighting for, you know. You see what he's done is a masterpiece of his prismatic style. He's done a tribute to St. Lucia using a style of art he invented. And I'm not going to question the old man's use of color. Luigi and I went to Jamaica to study for 3 years, and we didn't understand the use of color. The man was a master of the use of color that even painting so long, there are many painters who cannot even begin to understand how Daddy would get certain tones of paint. The man was a giant. And there are things in painting that we have yet to learn, you know. I wouldn't question, you know. No way I'd question his. I'm not saying that the flag is undefatigable, you know, is thing. But he used his genius to create this gift for St. Lucia. And with his spirit of empowering his people. And his love for his country, all of this pulled out in this a political symbol that he created with his deep love and appreciation of the land, the people, the light.
How do you feel when you travel overseas and you're identified, and you in Saint Lucia, and you're identified as the son of Sir Dunstan St. Thomas, particularly in light of him having designed the flag?
Boy, let me tell you, they mistake me for Derek Walcott, because they always mistake Daddy for Derek Walcott. So they think that they're Derek are brothers, you know. So they always say, "Oh, Derek, or Sir Dunstan." They say, but Sir Dunstan also be so young. You understand? No, but honestly, I feel very proud. You know, we try not to. We always try to be humble and try to, you know, because the old man taught us that, you know, to be humble and to respect people. And don't step on people and stuff like that. So when it comes, people say, "Hey, send to her," you know, and things that, and they say, "Well, hey, that's Dunstan's son," or "How is your mom?" You know, and things like that. We try not to be big nose about it. You know, we try to be very humble about it. But Daddy left us a tremendous gift, but he didn't just leave it for us. He left it for St. Lucia. Daddy was always about St. Lucia. He taught us that from a child, from when we were children, to love St. Lucia and to love all people, black, white, yellow, that we all equals, and respect, love, work hard, have faith in God.
We are Dead Hero Society. Would you say that when it comes to Sir Dunstan, we treated him differently?
Why? Let me tell you.
Because as far as the Folk Research Center is concerned, he was made a national cultural hero. He was knighted. He was celebrated. He was honored. Not true?
Daddy.
Better could have been done for him, you think?
Daddy wouldn't have asked for more. Daddy's greatest honor was to be knighted by his to give the St. Lucia Cross. That was his highest honor, to be. It showed appreciation of his country, the country that he loved, that honorable Sir Dunstan. That was his greatest achievement, besides his children and his family. And, you know, his greatest achievement was the appreciation of being given the St. Lucia Cross by his home nation. You understand? That was really, because he was a man of tremendous national pride. And he always believed in how he could make things better for, you know? You're always dreaming of ways you could make things. That craft thing I mentioned earlier was a dream he always had, you know?
How do you think it'll be reacting right now to what is happening in our St. Lucian society, particularly with all the violence that we're experiencing of late, the politics, the unemployment impacting the nation's young people, the seeming lack of direction as far as the society is concerned?
I don't know. I'm an artist. So you artists think on the other side of, you know, we see our dreamers and stuff like that. We always see them all, you know. Daddy, what's happening now happened years ago. The seeds of it, we're reaping the seeds of something we planted years ago. When St. Lucia was given the gift of the comprehensive school years ago by the Canadian government, where you could learn auto mechanics, welding, drafting, fine art, commerce, typing, you know, all these skills, electronics and all kind of stuff. We never followed that model. Because we were not ready, maybe we were not ready for it at the time, but we're ready for it now. Had we continued that model throughout the education system, maybe things may have been different now. I think what our problem is two-pronged. I think it's our politics, because our politicians are playing on staying in power. And
those are out fighting to get in.
It's all about seeing power. And I think sometimes they've forgotten the people. So we have a new government in hand now. We have a lot of hope and aspirations that they're going to do the right thing. We have to, whatever government is in power is a government of the people, by the people. You understand? So we have to see, we have to hope this new government succeeds, and we have to see with the new budget that they do what they have to do. We have to hope that we get a politician that has a passion and hasn't forgotten where he's come from. You understand? We have, you grew up in a yard of people and stuff like that. You've seen the hardships and stuff like that. When you get into a big boy position, you forget where you come from and you pass with your windows up and stuff like that. I mean, I'm being, you know, but we need politicians. We need our politicians to have more passion.
As far as you're aware, was your father ever approached to contest elections in St. Lucia, to enter the political arena?
Daddy could never be a politician.
Why?
Because a politician is a salesman. A politician is a salesman. I'm not trying to insult anybody. Mm-hmm. I mean, we need our politicians. Everybody has a role. You understand? All I'm saying is that we need our politicians to be more impassioned and to... We have a serious problem now with our youth and unemployment and stuff like that. And going to the police is not going to solve the problem. You understand? There's a root core. There's something rotten somewhere, and we have to find it and cure it. We have to, you know, go back to finding solutions. You know, we have to, even if we do it on our own, we have, like I said, with little community groups, like what Bo Hinkson is doing, and different people, we have to start doing different things. We have to start making things happen. Start somewhere.
But back to your dad in politics. You're saying that he was never approached at all to serve at that level, to contest the election?
He could not have been a politician. Mm-hmm. The only thing Daddy was interested in, Daddy had a dream for St. Lucia that, like I said, he thought we'd be the new Singapore and the new so on. So he thought, you know, we thought that, you know, with all these brains, we'd be able to harness all these people and do something positive. You understand? I mean, we have Arthur Lewis that we're not even using his models in St. Lucia, you know? The whole world has appreciated him and we've forgotten him here. You understand? We have a lot, we just cannot see it. We're not using what we have. It's as if we need a huge human resource manager to say, boy, fellas, we've got to do this, we got to do that. We need to find ways to get our people going. We need to, as I said earlier, we are talented people, we are gifted people, we are beautiful people, and we have to have faith and hope and do the right thing. We don't necessarily have to depend on government, but each of us in our own way, myself with my art, you know, you in your profession as a journalist, we all have to do something positive to help the younger people coming up. We have to be more positive images for them, you know, because the coming into a world, they're fresh, they you know, they're impressionable and stuff like that. We have to do a lot more. And we're going to be blamed if anything, you know, because it's going to get more and more rotten if it doesn't stop now. We have to start now.
Just before we take a commercial break, with regard to the observance of National Flag Day, what are you hoping to happen? For example, next year and the year after, because I think we'll continue to observe National Flag Day every year?
Well, I'm hoping that it's going to be a much bigger celebration next year. So the ball is in Margot's hands, Margot at the archives. Mm-hmm. We're hoping with the assistance of the Governor General and the FRC, Mr. LaForce, and I'm going to throw all the support to the family and, you know, the families of, you know, the people who design the symbols. We're hoping it'll be more, because these things are symbols of recognition, symbols of our own national pride. Mm-hmm. You understand? In the States, it's a holiday. and there's a whole parade and stuff like that.
You mean the same thing will happen in the case of Saint Lucia?
But I mean, mm-hmm. we need to do something to celebrate our achievements. Mm-hmm. We need to celebrate our achievements, you know? I mean, in everybody goes through something that is rotten, but then you think of something positive. We must always try to think of the positive and not dwell on negative. We have to celebrate the goodness that we gifted with the beautiful pizzas and an island that is so hauntingly beautiful that every year we win most beautiful wedding destination in the world and stuff like that. You know, we gifted with music. I mean, the Calypsoans, they haven't even begun to understand how much they can use the Creole music and mix it in with the calypso and stuff to export it to the world. Yes, so much. We have a treasure in St. Lucia. We have a treasure, and we have very talented young people coming up. We cannot disappoint these children. We have to set the example.
You're watching Newsmaker Live on this National Flag Day. My guest this evening is Mr. Alwyn St. Omar, who is the son of Sir Dunstan St. Omar. When we come back, we'll be taking your calls and continuing the discussion. So please, stay with us. Thank you so much for staying with us. Once again, you're watching Newsmaker Live on DBS Television. We will put a telephone number on screen so that you can call right now with your questions and comments for my guest. And he is Alwyn St. Omar, who is the son of Sir Dunstan. And we continue to observe National Flag Day, that of course is today. And it marks the 50th anniversary, 50 years since the flag was first used when the island attained associated statehood. That's on March the 1st of 1967. So we await your calls right now for my guest, Mr. Alwyn St. Omar. We have a caller line. Good evening to you. You're on the air.
Good evening, Timothy.
Good evening to you.
Mr. St. Omar's son.
Good evening.
Good evening. Hi.
It's a great program tonight. Mm. I must say, I really appreciate that flag. Your father has done great, great, great artwork with that flag. And even right now, I have my flag hanging high on my home. I love the colors. And my biggest problem and disappointment was that decision, I think, they're coming out with to change the color of the flag. I think
No. A decision has not been taken, ma'am. It's a suggestion by Mr. Peter Josie.
Well, I don't think that suggestion makes any sense to me. The flag, the colors are very wonderful. It's outstanding. And when you look at we go overseas, we travel, and our flag is only here. We don't really appreciate the flag. But overseas, everybody appreciate our flag. And I think it should stay the way it is, and we love it. We love the colors. The colors is outstanding. The only thing I think we need to change is our mentality, our ways, our attitude. These are the things we need to change. But there's nothing wrong with the flag, and it is the best thing we ever had. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Okay. Well, this is right up my alley. I mean, this is wonderful.
We have another call. Good evening. This is Newsmaker Live. Once again, we're observing National Flag Day. And my guest this evening is Mr. Alwyn St. Omar, who is the son of Sir Dunstan St. Omar. And again, to talk about the flag and the effect that it has on you. And in terms of, okay, we have a call. Good evening. Go ahead, please, with your contribution.
Oh, yes. Good. Let me just turn the sound down.
Yeah.
Yes. Good evening, Mr. Polian.
Good evening to you, ma'am.
Good evening to Alwyn.
Good evening.
As much as I respect Mr. Josie, adding red would totally spoil the flag. I can tell you, blood is being shed in every country in the world, and they do not add red. I would say in concerning taking pride in the flag, I agree, the people do not take much pride in it. In fact, it's very disappointing. It is one of the most beautiful islands in the world, and the people of St. Lucia do not take pride in keeping it clean. I would like to see that change. But getting back to Sir Dunstan St. Omer, his knighthood was given to him way too late in his life. It never changed him 1 ounce, and much credit in that family has to be given to the mother. Good night.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Because I intended to, you just escaped me, I intended to speak about your mom as well, particularly, I'm just seeing the footage of your mom collecting, a plaque earlier on today in his honor. We have another call. Good evening to you. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Good evening, Mr. Foley.
Good evening to you, ma'am.
Good evening, Mr. St. Omer.
Good evening.
I am very, very proud of your dad. First of all, he taught me at school, and he designed the St. Lucia flag in the best way. The red, as the former caller said, is going to spoil the flag. I'm very proud of that family. That's a great family. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's focus a bit on your mom, and maybe we could just play the footage, you know, to show your mom collecting the, I think it was a plaque earlier on today. Yeah. How is your mom doing?
My mom is doing fine. She has been going to see her daughters overseas and stuff like that. But she's been the backbone of the family. While, you know, she's always been, you know, behind every great man, there's this woman.
Full point, we have a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hi, good evening to you, ma'am, you're on the air.
Good evening to Mr.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I am very happy to know that we have a wonderful flag. The flag was made after love and hard work and love for St. Lucia. I appreciate the flag very, very much. And we must not let when somebody works hard and they do work out of love. Love is of God. We have to appreciate that. And we have to pray for the family. And we have to show appreciation for this flag we have. It's the most beautiful flag we ever come across. God bless the family. And let us never change that flag, because we'll spoil the beauty of our country. Bye-bye.
Where are you calling from, ma'am?
I'm calling from Babolo.
Okay, thanks for calling. Have a good evening.
Thank you very much.
I am Sister Love.
Okay, Sister
from
Love.
Babolo.
Thank you. Appreciate the contribution. Yeah, what say you?
Yeah, very wonderful. Very nice. It shows the national pride, you know?
Let's continue to take your calls once again. This is Newsmaker Live on DBS Television on this National Flag Day. We have a call online. Good evening to you.
Good evening to
Hi.
You.
Hi. Good evening to you, ma'am.
Alwyn, how are you?
Good evening.
And good evening, Mr. Polio, as
good
well.
Good evening to you.
Evening.
Well, I am very proud of Mrs. St. Omer, because I know she has been stunned. She stood behind her husband, and she stood for the family. And her husband did a wonderful job with the flag. So I appreciate it very much. And you too, Alwyn, you are doing a very good job.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much for calling. How do you feel right now? Because we discussed your father, you hold him in high esteem, and now you're hearing those contributions coming from, and interesting enough, maybe that says something about your father. Only females we've had
Daddy,
calling the program so
Daddy
far. Let's take another call. Good evening. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Hi. Good
Hi,
evening,
good evening
Timothy and Mr. St. Omer.
Good evening to you.
Good evening. Hi.
Hey, our flag is beautiful, and it is simply beautiful, and this is St. Lucia. Thank you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
You very much.
We will, I was asking the question earlier on. How do you feel when you
Okay, interrupted by another call. Good evening, go ahead with your contribution caller.
Good evening.
Hi, good evening to you.
Hello.
Hi, good evening, you're on the air.
Good evening, Mr. Poulayan. Good evening, Mr. Santoma.
Good evening to you, ma'am.
I'd just like to make a small contribution. A very proud St. Lucian, very proud of the color of the flag. The colors of the flag complement each other. Like Mr. Santoma said, his father was an excellent colorist, obviously, because that color palette is second to none. Red, no doubt, will destroy the symmetry of the flag. But the other thing I want to comment on is the fact that St. Lucians seem to not understand that the flag is an important national symbol and use it on cars, on all sorts of things, which is probably not the best way to show our national pride. The way we should do that is being proud of our surroundings by not littering, by inculcating that into our children so that we become a prouder nation of our surroundings and of our country. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Respect for the flag. Allow me to piggyback on that. What say you to this?
Yeah, the flag is our most recognizable national symbol. It's our identity throughout the world. You know, you cannot desecrate the flag. You cannot. It's part of us.
Good evening. Go ahead with your contribution, caller.
Good afternoon, Mr. Puglia.
Good evening to you, sir.
Good evening, Alwyn.
Good evening, sir.
Was the flag painted in the CDC area?
Hello?
Was the flag painted?
Was the flag painted in the CDC area?
Yes, it was. Yes. When we lived in Central Castries in the 60s.
Right. CDC boys. Bye-bye.
Yeah, CDC Central Castries.
All right. Thank you so much for calling. Okay. Okay, we wait another call. I don't want to pose another question to you, and then we interrupted by a call. Good evening. Go ahead with your contribution, caller.
Good evening.
Hi. Good evening to you, ma'am.
I have no issues with the flag. The colors are perfect, except for the fact that when we are celebrating independence or putting up the flags for different occasions, I think that we St. Lucians need to know the right color. Because what I notice, like, during independence time, sometimes you see all different types of blue flags flying across St. Lucia, which is bad. So I think we need to know the exact color and keep it standard. And another thing, since we have been seven times British, seven times French, I think we could add like seven teardrops of red on the flag. So I have no problem with adding the red to it. But as seven teardrops to illustrate the seven times British, seven times French.
Okay, thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.
What say you?
Who am I to interfere with the gentleman's labor of love? Like
we have another contributor online. Good evening.
Hi, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, sir.
Good evening, always, Mrs. Santoma.
Good evening.
I think I followed the last caller. She made a very good point until the teardrops. I think in celebrating the flag and our achievement as a people, we need to be consistent. And she made a very valid point in terms of the color of the flag. I find persons are too hell-bent on making money out of selling flags, and you have the colors all over the place. We need to be consistent in terms of the color that we use, especially the blue. And just to add to that, it has been a pleasure knowing Mr. Santoma. I knew him personally. And it shows in the flag, you know. He was humble and he is simple. And it shows in the simplicity of the design of the flag. This was a great man, and it was a pleasure knowing him. And I know Alwyn as well, personally. And Alwyn, I'm sitting here in Monrepo talking about that, and I could see your father sitting on the steps outside. I think you know who was talking now.
Yeah.
A very humble, very simple man. And it shows in his work. But continue doing the job that you're doing, Alwyn, taking over the legacy of your father and the other brothers.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for calling, sir.
Thank you. The Pantone colors, you know, that's been standardized.
Okay. Okay, maybe we could make reference.
Yeah, but I can't see it closer.
Okay. All right, we have a call. Good evening. This is Newsmaker Live. Please go ahead with your contribution, caller.
Yeah. Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
It's nice to see the Alwyn there actually representing the family. And we will always think of Sir Dunstan when we see the flag, and we know that it came from the heart, like a lady said a while ago. It was full of love for his country. But I have to agree with the other callers before me. This has been a sore point for me, that the color blue is never consistent. I'm seeing royal blue, I'm seeing aquamarine, I'm seeing turquoise, and I know it's supposed to be cerulean blue. And I wish that we would get it right, you know, because in all countries, all flags, you see the same colors consistently. You don't see different shades of red or yellow or whatever. So we need to get that right. 38 years, in fact, it's more than 38 years, 40, 50 years for the flag. We should have the blue right. I think it's not right seeing all different color blues, even in national events where you see royal blue, you know, and it's definitely not royal blue. So this is something I think that we need to address and as a nation be consistent with the color that we use. And in fact, the color that the Dunstan designed the flag.
It is.
Okay. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks a lot. What is preventing us from getting it right? Alwyn.
I don't know, maybe the different manufacturers, but it was standardized just before the last independence when Daddy changed the color. And we have the Pantone colors here.
Okay.
You know, if I may just briefly look, the cerulean blue is number RGB 99207254, and the manufacturers have been given these colors. So okay. I don't know why we're still getting the colors wrong. Maybe it's just,
Could anyone print the flags? Okay, we have a call. Good evening. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Good evening, Timothy.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Okay, good evening to you and your guests. I would like to say that we have a unique flag and that I don't believe any changes should be made to it. It was just a suggestion, but I don't believe that suggestion should play out at all. I want to ask a question. The original color, which is yellow now, I would like to ask Mr. Sentome, what was the original color? Was it gold or yellow?
Okay.
Because I remember far back when the flag came into existence, I want to believe that the color was gold. But now we have the yellow. And also the blue, people have touched on the blue. And one other problem I have, Timothy, is that when you put up the banner for independence, when you look at the banner after it is put up, it looks like something that has been chewed by a cow.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't look good at all. It doesn't tell of the pride we have and the pride we should have in our flag. So I would like the powers that be or the people that put it on and off, when it is taken down after independence, it should be folded properly and put away. So when you put it up again, it stands out. That's my contribution for tonight. Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
You heard?
I didn't hear.
Okay,
didn't
but hear. She was the question she posed was about the color. Is it yellow or gold? We know it's gold, right?
It's gold.
It's gold. But it doesn't appear gold here, right?
Yeah, I think yellow is used as a representation of gold. Mm-hmm. Because it made difficulty in printing gold.
Right. And also, she's talking about the state of the banners. Normally, the national colors and
yes.
so on, they are put on, and when they are put down, they appear to be so rumpled up and so on, disheveled, and, you know?
Yeah. It's about the pride in what we do. If we take in normal banners, we're supposed to fold them and put them. You know, it's just about, if we do anything, do it right, do it well. So it's just a matter of the way we saw things and do things. But I guess that's the city council or whoever responsible
okay.
for that.
We continue to take your calls. This is Newsmaker Live right here on DBS Television. We have at least 5 more minutes in terms of calls, so you can continue to take the opportunity to make a contribution to our program this evening as we continue to observe National Flag Day, and we are graced with the presence of the son of the individual who designed the flag, Sir Dunstan St. Omar. Do we have a caller line, producer? Okay, we have a call. Good evening, go ahead with your contribution. Hello? Hello, good evening. Hello, good evening to you, caller. Okay, well, we have lost that call, so let us see if we can get another individual who will be calling into the program to either make a comment or to pose a question. Good evening.
Hello, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you. Go ahead, please.
I have a different take on that. Well, it's true the flag is a beautiful flag. It represents so much of our culture and everything else. But don't you think that people should, on Independence Day, I think people should, every single solution should be able to take part in that independence thing, because people like in the public sector, yeah, they get to celebrate and all that, but in the public sector like me, we never get a chance to do anything. I think that should be a national holiday and should remain a national holiday, so every single Saint Lucian can benefit from that, because it's not nice to see, well, everybody's on their business. You want to celebrate, but you can't because of your position and, I mean, where you work. It should be something else. I honestly believe they should really look into that, so every single person, every single Saint Lucian can take part in the independence.
Well, it cannot really happen because, I mean, for example,
yeah,
the police officers, they must be on duty, the doctors, the nurses. Thank you so much for calling. Maybe you could listen off the television set. But the point she's saying is that it should truly be a national event that every Saint Lucian will be able to participate in such an activity. I think she's talking about maybe not working on that day.
Like Labor Day.
Like, yeah. But clearly it cannot happen. Because some people not be able to do it. I mean, you have the emergency services people, the police, and so on.
Yeah.
All right, we have the call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Good evening, Mr. Polio.
Hi, good evening to you, sir.
Good evening, Mr. St. Omar.
Good evening, sir.
I say the flag is a job well done.
Okay, Mr. Producer, we're having some interference. Please help us. We need to listen to the caller. Thank you. Oh, okay, we lost the call. Oh, okay. But let's await your calls. We know that one will be coming in very soon. I'm just predicting because so far we've had so many calls. Another caller line. Good evening, Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Perfectly designed, and I am speaking to Mr. Saint-Omer, Olin Saint-Omer now. Mr. Saint-Omer, I know that you're an excellent artist.
Thank you.
But I think I should be hearing more about you. Oh. You're too much in the background. You should come out and for me to hear you and for me to see your work, because I know you can work. You're a very good artist. I know you personally.
Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. Just like your father, maybe you don't like to promote yourself, you don't like the glamour, the limelight. What say to this?
Well, see, I do a lot of work, you know, but usually I do a lot of work at private homes because I'm an artist, I paint and stuff like that, except for my murals in private spaces.
Right.
Yeah, I have one or two murals that were labels of love, really, which was like pulling teeth, getting them done. But I intend to get a lot more involved. I think getting involved may be the solution, as we spoke earlier.
For that point. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hey, good evening, Timothy. Good evening, Alwyn.
Good evening to you, sir.
Good evening.
Yeah, I really couldn't miss out on the opportunity to just to say the words, happy National Flag Day. I mean, that sounds excellent. I really hope it becomes a bigger thing next year. And I really concur with all of the persons who have expressed, you know, their delight at what we have as our flag, and I'm not even sure why we're discussing a change of colors and whatnot for the flag. You know, to me, well, as has been said, it was just a suggestion by Mr. Josie, but I don't think that's going to go very far, because this flag is really respected, you know, far and wide, and I think it has been seen as a real masterpiece, you know. But I'd just like to commend the family for continuing to keep up the legacy, and I really hope that this becomes a big thing in St. Lucia, National Flag Day, because I think an excellent a masterpiece has been created by Alwyn's dad, and I really hope that we can keep that going.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir.
That's our final call. Let's take the final comments from you, Alwyn.
Well, I'm happy with the calls, kind of calls we've gotten, and I'm hoping that this is the beginning. We hope this can be a start, to celebrating our achievements. And the National Flag Day is really about celebrating our achievements, our history. You understand? And I hope that next year, like the gentleman said, it's going to be an even bigger thing. Because we have to start celebrating what's good in ourselves. It's all around us, but we don't recognize it. We see the negative things all the time. We have to celebrate. And I'm hoping that maybe for our 50th anniversary, the National Monument of St. Lucia might finally be up. Mm-hmm. I designed it, 28 years ago when I was at school in Jamaica, and my dad really wanted to see it up. But so far, it was supposed to mark the 10th anniversary of independence, 28 years ago.
Why the hold up?
I don't know. Well, you know, in our part of the world, a structure like this may be seen as something too extravagant. But when I design it, I design it to, like that, you know, I design it to show. At the time, I designed it in the form of the St. Lucian Parrot in abstract, because at the time, our national bird was an endangered species. So I designed an abstract structure that showed the hope of a fledgling nation. You understand, a young nation hoping to strive to do greater things. But maybe one day a friendly government may build it for us. The idea is to put something like, the concept is like the Statue of Liberty, 60, 70 foot on the waterfront. The original, again, it was a competition that we had, you know, and Alexis Felix and myself had different designs. And Alexis Felix designed one, the structure for the base and the park that would go underneath, because we're supposed to have like craft centers and stuff like that on the base while the monument stood towering, you know. And something like that would change the look of Castries, give us modernize. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine the aircraft coming in, the tourists walking from Point Surfing to this magnificent. I know with our present situation, we need the hospitals and stuff like that. But perhaps a friendly government can do this, and it would be a tourist attraction, and it would be a form of income and create employment as well.
Alwyn, enjoyed it thoroughly. Thank you so much for being my guest.
Thank you very much.
On this evening's Newsmaker Live.
Thank you.
And of course, we continue to observe and celebrate National Flag Day. My name is Timothy Polio. Thank you so much for contributing via your calls. If it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live. Time now for the clip that peaked.
Thank you.
Once again, thank you so much for watching this evening's Newsmaker Live. My name is Timothy Polio. See you next time.